I'm Jamie Siebold. I'm from SPS. I'm one of the regional sales managers here. John, if you don't mind introducing yourself.
My name is John Cook. I'm a CPO. I'm a clinical education manager at College Park. I've been with College Park for about 3 years. Before that, I was in clinical care, I believe, here in Michigan for about 20 years before that. We do a lot of the clinical education courses at shows like this, getting on distributors, international and domestic. I do some in-person training with our groups, and also manage the tech team, answers most of the calls if you have any trouble or questions on some of our products. So
our customer can call in and you know, help. You can answer questions on the technical aspects of any of your products?
Any of the specs, and they certainly, we can help with product selection too, if you're not sure. It's never been more difficult to pick a foot, I think, for prosthetics. I mean, we 15 feet alone in our catalog. How do I pick, if I'm a K3, how do I pick within those products? There are certain things that you give us some information on your patient and what they want to do, and certainly help you, guide you to the right product.
Awesome. So with that being said, let's talk a little bit about the Odyssey feet. I know that you have a K2 version and a K3.
Yeah, we can get started with start with K2 and move up to the K3. The K2 is one of our best-selling feet. And the unique thing about our hydraulics is this curved hydraulic cylinder. Close I can get in here. The hydraulic cylinder is very small, and it's a curved cylinder as well. So you have a pivot point that's really about the anatomical ankle axis. So you have a single pivot point, which allows us to build it very short. So we are the lowest build hydraulic feet in the market, both at K2 and the K3 level. And that's because of that unique curved hydraulic cylinder that's all packaged right up here in the front. It has independent adjustments of both the dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. Because the build height of the foot is so low, it's actually down just underneath the top of the foot shell itself. But those adjustments are done with a 3-millimeter wrench we send with you with the foot. And that's independent adjustment of both plantar flexion and dorsiflexion hydraulics.
So can you access those adjustments with the foot shell on?
Absolutely, right from the top. And it's right at the edge there. So even if you wanted to get creative with cosmetic finishing, you could probably provide a little bit of an opening there to make any adjustments. Typically, most patients don't necessarily need to make adjustments to those hydraulic resistances once they've been fit and gone through that dynamic alignment process. But it's real easy. And the adjustments, the range on the adjustment is about 180 degrees of a turn. So it just takes very small changes in that adjustment setting in order to make changes to the hydraulic resistance. So the nice thing about that is when you have a static foot, if I want to have more heel or more toe, I have to make an alignment change to it, right? So I have to dorsiflex the foot if I want softer toe per se, or more of a firmness to the heel. Hydraulic adjustments, you can make asymmetrical adjustments. So I can firm up both the heel resistance and the toe resistance functionally by increasing the resistance to the hydraulics on both of those. And if I want to get more motion out of the composites, I can firm up the hydraulic resistance even more, and that's going to bring the composite activity into play a little bit more. So the easier the hydraulics move, the less you're getting action out of the composites. And the firmer those hydraulics are, the more you're going to get some of the motion out of the composite material. And the composites are really the biggest difference between the K2 and the K3 is going to be the composite platform that it's based on. K2 is based on our Celsius platform, which is made out of our IntelliWeave material. I know fiberglass is kind of all the rage these days. A lot of our feet have been a glass composite blend for the last 30 years, and that includes the Celsius platform. And our Celsius platform is, again, our Celsius is one of our big, big sellers. I think we have like a 0.03% return rate on that for warranties. So Celsius is a bulletproof battleship type of foot, does not have any returns on it at all. And that's the platform that the K2 is built on.
Okay, now with a K2 patient, is there a recommended setting to start with for those patients, or is it just based on patient feel? You know, what would you recommend?
So when it comes to you from us, it's going to be at minimum resistance. Typically, what we'll do is have the patient stand at that very low resistance and see how they balance in the foot. If they're feeling like they're falling backwards, you can increase the plantar flexion hydraulic resistance. That's going to give them a little bit more posterior stability. And if they feel like they have a tendency to fall forward, again, you can increase that hydraulic resistance to dorsiflexion. Really, you get that first balance point for standing and your static alignment. And then have the patient walk and see how they're progressing. So if they're coming to foot flat too quickly and they're getting almost like a foot slap, obviously you're going to increase that plantar flexion resistance. And if they're progressing too forward too quickly over the foot, you're going to increase that dorsiflexion hydraulic resistance. So most of those resistances, again, we tend to start pretty loose. If I have a patient, it may also depend on what foot they're coming off of. So if I have a patient if it's their first foot, then preconceived notion as to what it'll feel like. And if you're concerned with their stability, my suggestion would be ramp up both of those resistances. And what that's going to do is provide kind of the most stable foot, right, to start. If you've got somebody who's coming off of a foot that's got a lot of motion to it, they may be more comfortable with less resistance. So some of it's kind of a consideration of what they're coming off of, if they're transitioning from a different foot. You know, everybody kind of knows or anticipates how that patient is going to stand up when they first get up on a prosthesis and their inherent stability. I always talk about the balance between stability and mobility. So the more mobile a foot is, the less stable it is. So the more stable your patient is, the more mobile that foot can be. So that's kind of where you kind of have to use your judgment as to whether I want it to be stable to start with or I want it to have a lot of movement.
Now, what's the weight limit?
275 on it. So before we get to the K3 version, most of the hydraulics are very similar, but if you think they're going to look a little bit different, K2 over here versus the K3. So you can see it's a little bit beefier hydraulic unit on the top. So we're anticipating, obviously, somebody's going to be a little more aggressive, a little more active on that K3. So the hydraulic unit itself is a little more substantial, but it still has that curved hydraulic cylinder. The build height's going to be just a little bit taller because of that more substantial hydraulic cylinder, but everything else is going to be, again, that still have that same nice low build height. Your adjustments to the hydraulics are on the top as well. Other than the hydraulic unit being a little bit beefier, a little bit stronger on the K3, the other biggest change is now we're on a more dynamic or more energy return type of platform. So we're going from the Celsius platform, which is a little bit lower activity and more flexible, Horizon platform. And the Horizon platform is a straight carbon fiber design. And that straight carbon fiber design is going to give a lot more energy return. Again, you're anticipating somebody at that K3 level being a little more aggressive. So that's going to give you a little more energy return. One thing I do want to note, and this will affect some of the Odyssey that K3, is the platform that we built it on, again, is the Horizon. And we did recently just make changes to that Horizon platform. So the Horizon springs, we made a redesign to the springs and also the ankle housing. And so these springs have a little bit more dynamic. So we've made some changes to the layup of some of the composites. And also the attachment point of the two composite springs was moved more anterior, more distal to the toes. So that provides an even more dynamic heel and a smoother rollover to the toe from the old Horizon. So that will obviously translate into the Odyssey K3. The other difference that we made was increasing the ankle housing is a little more substantial. Again, is the platform that we're basing. You're gonna get the other change is the pyramid attachment. So on the Horizon, which again will translate to that Odyssey K3, we moved the pyramid placement slightly more distal as well, or more toward the toe. So anterior distal. And that's makes it a little bit easier to align. We had some people that were struggling with alignment because that anchor point was a little more posterior in the past. So some of those were being responsive to some of the input we were getting from practitioners, from clinicians, try to make it a little more user-friendly. But again, that's going to be changes that will also translate to the Odyssey. Other difference in the Odyssey K3 is our weight limit is down a little bit because, again, we're anticipating a little more aggressive, a little more higher activity level. In order to make those hydraulics, make sure they can stand up to the higher activity level, we did drop the weight rating down to 220 on this. So it is a little bit lower on the K3. Hydraulic adjustments are the same, and you're just getting a little more dynamic or a little more high energy platform.
With that being said, maybe you don't see it. Have you seen patients move from the K2 Odyssey into a K3 Odyssey based on their progressions? I mean, obviously, if they started out with the K2 version, and mm-hmm. progressed over time. It's a pretty easy transition into a K3, I would imagine.
That's a real smooth transition. The biggest difference in the hydraulic setup between the two, so we have the platforms that are slightly different, but also so we have 12 degrees of motion in both platforms, so both the K2 and the K3. The K2, we have more plantar flexion built into that hydraulic range, so there's 11 degrees of plantar, one of dorsi. In the K3, we have 9 degrees of plantar and 3 of dorsi. So the idea behind that is a knee stability for your K2 patients. They tend to be a little less stable, a little less inherent stability. So we don't want a real large knee flexion moment at early stance to destabilize the knee. So we're providing more plantar flexion on the K2 level. So that's the only thing that they may have to get to a little bit is that range. But we're assuming, again, if they're transitioning from the K2 up to that K3 level, then they've developed a lot more of their own inherent stability and strength. They're capable of accommodating those changes to the range of motion. That's a real easy transition. If you're used to the movement of hydraulics and that anatomical movement of the hydraulic ankle joint, it's a real easy transition going from the two to the three.
With your experience, I'm sure you've seen or heard a lot of patient feedback regarding, you know, maybe a fixed ankle foot to hydraulic ankles. You know, what's a typical feedback or typical patient response to that?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think at first it's kind of a whoa, there's just movement. It depends to some extent how long they've been on those static ankles. But yeah, generally speaking, you're going to get that response of, you know, I can move around and my foot still stays flat on the ground, right? Mm-hmm. I don't have to feel like I'm tipping one way or the other, or my toes stick up in the air, or my heel comes off of the ground. So I tend to notice that the most is not necessarily as much in level ground walking, but when they start hitting those down slopes and up slopes, it's just there's less pressure being translated up through the pylon and into the socket. So I think you get a lot of reduction in socket pressures too when you're accommodating that movement at the ankle joints. Instead of those, we get deflection of composites in your static ankle feet, and we make a lot of those too. But those movements, compression of a heel composite, that movement still is getting translated up through that pylon into socket. I think the biggest thing, you get a greater increased socket comfort. And then again, those slopes, up slopes and down slopes, anybody who's on those really notices that decreased pressures and really a lot easier to go up or down slopes with that hydraulic ankle system.
So less energy expenditure.
That's what it's all about. Obviously, there's some benefit as well to toe clearance. When you have, you're passively, as the patient is progressing into late stance, they're getting into a dorsiflex position. There's less of an issue with stubbing the toe, catching the toes through swing as well. But yeah, I think it's less energy expenditure. They may have to utilize a little bit more of your postural muscles than maybe you do in a static foot, because they are required to provide some of their own stability of the movement of that ankle joint, even in quiet standing. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. In the long run, you're still providing energy expenditure.
Welcome, Eric.
Hello.
We're just reviewing the K2 and the K3 Odyssey.
It's my favorite thing that we make.
We think so too. So Eric, you know, John was just kind of explaining some patient feedback that he typically hears in the field. Can you share with any experiences you've had about patient response or patient feedback from the Odyssey?
Well, I have talked to somebody who really enjoys how smooth the motion is. They were using the K3 and they had been using some other feet before, but they really like how smooth that transition is in every step of the way. And I think we've only just improved it over the years when it comes to the whole shebang, the whole product. I think that's great. And then like our prosthetists that we've talked to, they really, really like how low profile it is, both the K3 and the K2. A lot of other hydraulics are very tall, whereas ours, with the curved hydraulic, it's a real compact device.
Awesome. Appreciate that feedback, Eric. We've talked a little bit about the Odyssey line of feet. I know that you have a new knee coming out, I believe called the Capital Hydraulic Knee. What can you share with us about the knee coming out, and when do you expect it to launch?
Well, the knee is set to launch on September 23rd, so we're about a little less than 2 weeks out from that. We are certainly ramping up production and getting things done. Pretty excited about that process. We've been working through a lot of beta testing as well, and still have some people walking on the knee as well, some of our stronger beta testers that we have. But this is the Capital knee right here, and the goal behind the Capital was we were trying to get into the hydraulic knee market, but trying to do things a little bit differently, and trying to do things, maybe make some improvements on some of the product that was established product that's in this market as is. So we are a single axis hydraulic swing and stance. That's in a nutshell, that's the function. It's aluminum frame with a replaceable hydraulic cylinder that's in the back. It'll be field serviceable. So obviously we hope you never have to swap that out. But even if it's something where the hydraulics go after the warranty period and is a 3-year warranty period on the knee, you could replace just the hydraulic cylinder itself and not have to replace the entire knee.
Really easy to do too, right? Just a couple screws and...
couple screws at the top here and then down at the bottom as well. So it's a very easy, and we'll send all of the hardware that you need to replace it as well. So that'll come with a kit for the hydraulic cylinder. We have a three-mode function, which is an exciting feature of the knee. It's very easy to toggle between those three modes at the back of the knee, at the proximal aspect of the cylinder. You're going to be able to go into normal mode, which is where it'll be probably 90% of the time. But we also have the option of going to a locked mode, so the patient can toggle that switch over to the left-hand side, and it will enter into very high flexion resistance. So it's not a physical lock, but it's a hydraulic lock, so it's a very high resistance to flexion. Now, the nice part about that is you don't have to be in full extension to enter into that mode. You don't have to have weight on the toe. You don't have to have weight on the knee. You don't have to be in any particular angle of the knee. If I'm sitting down and I know, hey, I'm going to stand up, but I'm going to be standing at my job and I'm going to be standing at the trade show booth for the next 2 hours, and I don't want to have to think about my knee and stabilizing that knee. So I'm going to stand up. I can switch that mode over into locked mode. And then as I stand up and I go into extension, wherever I stop in extension, I'm going to have resistance to flexion, but I'll still be able to go into extension. So now once I get all the way up, I'm in that locked position. It's also something that, you know, you can utilize swinging a golf club or something along those lines. If you want to maintain that position in a slightly flexed position, you can do the other mode other than that normal mode, going to be your free swing mode. So once I flip over to the other side, now I'm bypassing stance, and now I just have slight hydraulic resistance to both flexion and extension, but I can utilize that for biking, or some people will utilize that for jogging as well, where they don't want that stance resistance to kick in. Other nice feature of this knee, how easy it is to adjust for the prosthetist, right? So we want it to be easy for the patient to use, but we obviously want it to be easy for the prosthetist to use. And you don't need any special tools, any special wrenches. You're not turning any dials. We have three adjustments for the hydraulic control of the knee, and they're all right at the back of the knee here. So I have stance flexion adjustment. So I'm adjusting my resistance to flexion and stance. So that's at both that early stance when the heel first hits the ground, and also for our stair descent or ramp descent. And then the other time that's going to come into play is, again, stand to sit. So you have to kind of fine tune and play with that and see what fits the best for all of those functions. But that's my stance flexion resistance. And then I have swing flexion and swing extension resistance, again, that are all made with that 4 millimeter wrench. Swing flexion resistance is going to limit my heel rise, control how much that heel is coming up in early swing. And then my extension resistance is going to limit that terminal impact or keep the knee from going too hard into full extension. Those are the three major adjustments that are adjustable when you're in that normal walking mode. There's one other adjustment that's a little hard to see, but there is, when I flex the knee slightly, the fourth adjustment here that's made with a 2.5 mil wrench. And what that is, our trigger stance, trigger sensitivity. What we mean by that is how easily the knee is going to trigger into swing. Sometimes you have your more aggressive patients and they're getting that knee, they're getting out onto the toe, they're really extending the knee, and the knee may want to trigger into swing too quickly or too easily. You can make an adjustment to that setting, and that will make it harder for them to trigger the knee into swing. Again, for sometimes your more aggressive patients, you may want that. You can also make it easier to trigger into swing. So if you have somebody who's really not getting out to that toe and they're taking smaller steps, or it's their first prosthesis, you can increase the sensitivity of that and allow them to trigger the knee into swing more easily. That's a unique adjustment for the capital as well. And then some of the physical features that we have on it, there's a kneeling pad here on the top anterior aspect. There's what we like to call kind of a kneecap here as well when you flex the knee. So the fact that that plastic cowling is there means you're not going to get clothing and such pinched down in that opening of the knee in itself. And then these plastic materials here on the side, I have the black on black version here, so it's hard to really see where they are. But these different plastic pieces can be one of four different colors. So in the front and the two sides and these two caps at the top can be either black, white, gray, or red. So we have some literature. They want to swing by our booth. We have some literature that shows all the different renderings of those different colors. And then the very last physical feature, unless Erik tells me I'm forgetting something. So on this one, I have our pyramid distal attachment, but we also have a version that's a pylon receiver on the distal end. So again, it just depends on your alignment of your patient. If they're pretty straightforward in alignment and you want to use that distal tube receiver, That'll come straight out of the bottom, and that's a 34 millimeter tube. Or if you want more freedom to make alignment or tilting of that knee joint itself, you can utilize that pyramid option, and then you have more alignment freedom there at the bottom.
Does it come with obviously a pyramid top? Do you have a threaded top as well?
Do not at this point have a threaded top. One of the reasons we didn't do a threaded top initially is because of our build height. And the build height from the axis of rotation to the pyramid is, I believe, 0.67 inches. So it's a little more than half an inch, but it's very low profile on your build height. So even with your longer limbs, you're still not adding a lot of build height from your attachment point to your axis of rotation of the knee. So it's a real low profile build. So we do not have a threaded top option at this point. We've talked to engineering about the possibility of that in the future. So
thanks for visiting, Eric.
Thanks. Thanks for having me. Good luck in the rest.
Now, John, what's the weight limit on the capital hydraulic knee?
The weight limit is going to be 330 pounds. I'm glad you asked me that. Couple of things. One, the 330 pounds, so that's a pretty high weight limit, 150 kilograms for those of you not in the U.S. And then the weight of the knee itself is 990 grams or 980, depending on the distal attachment option that you have. So we're under a kilogram, which is, again, about 2 pounds. So weight-wise, we're going to be one of the lightest in this category of knee, and that high weight capacity really helps fit your patients at that upper end of the range. I know people are still always asking for a 500 pound knee, and we haven't quite gotten there yet. 330 pounds should let you fit a good number of patients, even at the higher end of the weight limit.
Certainly looks like a great knee to pair with an Odyssey K3, right?
Absolutely, yeah, hydraulics and hydraulics. Or the soleus, which we've got on there. Yeah, I think the more, you know, we always talk about that when we're pairing knees and feet. The more movement you have at the ankle, the less you're probably going to utilize at the knees. Firmer heel is going to utilize more of that stance flexion in the knee. A softer heel, you'll more inherent stability at that knee. Obviously, those two always kind of work together. But yeah, it would be something that you could pair pretty easily. And again, obviously, hydraulic feet add a little bit of weight relative to your static ankle feet, but the fact that the knee itself is very lightweight, I wouldn't hesitate to add a hydraulic foot mechanism, a foot and ankle on underneath this knee. I think you'd still be okay weight-wise for the overall prosthesis.
Awesome. Well, John, I certainly appreciate your time that you've spent with us today. A lot of great information. Look for the capital hydraulic knee, you said, September 23rd.
So we can probably take some pre-orders before then.
One more thing though, John, you know, obviously a lot of our practitioners out there like to demo products and try them out prior to purchasing and make sure the patient's comfortable. Is that an option with the capital?
Absolutely. Yeah. With all of our products, you've got 30 to 60 days if for some reason the patient doesn't like it. The other option that you'll have, if we have somebody who wants to just take a look at the knee itself and physically see it. You know, obviously with the current situation, it's harder for our sales team to get out and see people. We're gonna be providing demos to facilities as well. So if somebody wants to order a demo unit from us, we'll send you kind of this setup here. So you'll get a T-handle, the knee pylon, and a foot underneath it. And then you can kind of really play with the function of the knee. If for some reason you wanted to, that would be a knee that you could try out with the patient as well. So yeah, we can certainly work with you. Anybody who wants to demo the knee, we can, once our guys are getting back out in the field a little bit more, we can have them swing by and help you out with some of those fittings too. So yeah, demos are not a problem. We're trying to be creative with how we get the new stuff in everybody's hands. So I know it's hard for me to say, yeah, I want to buy it until I've seen it and held it and made every little adjustment possible. So yeah, if anybody that wants a demo or wants to see it, by all means, reach out to us. And then we can always do one of these things once you do have it and Zoom with our team and walk you through all features and functions and adjustments and stuff.
Sounds great. I'm assuming you can call your College Park sales representative, also your SPS sales rep. I believe we have demos on the way coming from College Park. So reach out to either of us and we certainly get the customer hooked up with the demo unit for sure. Like I said, John, appreciate your time. A lot of great info. I'm looking forward to seeing the knee and see how it does. And we'll talk soon.
Thanks, Jamie.